Hi, Walter.
Oh, hi.
I wanted to come back to the puppet question.
Oh, okay.
I came across a text of yours that, it seems, has remained rather unknown. The title is In Praise of Puppets.
Ah, that one. It must have been 1930 or so. But it is only a review of a book by Max von Böhm, a cultural historian, an illustrated two-volume work, one about puppets and the other one about puppet theaters. As far as I recall, I was not very fond of them.
Your main objection is that the book is rather superficial, his author acting as a tourist guide without any fascination for his topic.
But I also recommend the book. For example, because it gives a very good description of the puppets made by Lotte Pritzel. Here is what von Böhm writes about them. And I quote, "With respect to these creatures, one barely dares using the expression puppet, since the word very easily becomes misleading. These figures have a psychological gravity that constitutes a striking contrast to their tender, butterfly-like appearance. The faces are visionary, morbid. The bodies over-slim, their attitude twisted. Fascinating, distressing if you like, is the sexlessness of these puppets, which in their expression and their ambiguous dressing possess something like an enticing uncertainty."
But in your review, you make rather clear that von Böhm does not at all understand the magic of puppets. In particular, you object that his writing about puppets is completely without passion, so cool and busy, up to the point where you seem to smell, during your reading, the beer mist of taverns for Nazi gatherings.
Well, that last remark was a little too harsh, perhaps. However, what I was missing in this cultural history was a kind of radical subjectivity, an obsession similar to what drove myself in collecting children's books and toys.
Still, you call von Böhm's work a treasure trove. I suspect not just because it repeatedly talks about Goethe and Faust as a puppet theater play, but also because it underscores the connection between puppets and cinema.
Oh, does it? I hardly recall that. But now that you mention it, you're probably right. Von Böhm deals with the shadow plays coming from Asia to Europe in the 17th century. And in this connection, he also speaks about the silhouette animations pioneered by Lotte Reininger in the 1920s.
I have the impression this was a rather crucial point for you. I mean, because you also draw some interesting parallels between puppets and the cinema.
That might be true. But then again, I did not really need von Böhm for this kind of argument. Much more important in this respect was a short text written by Charles Baudelaire in the 1850s. I'm sorry. In this text, Philosophy of Toys, Baudelaire describes the special significance that puppets have for children. His main point concerns the profound relatedness of life and art. For example, he describes how everyday objects, such as chairs, can take on a life of their own when integrated into the children's puppets' play. By the same token, Baudelaire mentions optical toys that are used for animating drawings, for example, the phenakistoscope, which I'm sure you know figures prominently in the history of cinematography.
Interesting. In your radio pieces, you also bring together puppets and the cinema. For example, in Berlin Toy Tour, you talk about the puppets you marveled at in a large department store while also being fascinated with the flip books and zootropes or wheels of life on display. Now, these latter ones also belong to the prehistory of cinematography. So why is this aspect so important to you?
Well, this is certainly not just about Felix the Cat or Mickey Mouse. Although I admit I was rather into these animations in the 1930s. In German, the early cinema used to be called Lichtspiel or photoplay. I'm struck by the terminological resonance this establishes between new media technologies and the world of play. My point here is that play is always liberating. Surrounded by a world of giants, children use play to create a world appropriate to their size. But the adult, who finds himself threatened by the real world and can find no escape, removes its sting by playing with its image in reduced form. So the more technological our world becomes, the more essential I take these rooms for play to be.
Very interesting. This reminds me of the things Deleuze in his cinema books says about Buster Keaton. I mean the ways in which Keaton contributes to the mining of technology by taking the biggest machine in the world and making it work with the tiniest elements, thus converting it for the use of each one of us, making it the property of everyone.
This seems very similar indeed, in particular since minor signifies small or tiny, but also stands for underage person or child. But be that as it may, my point is that puppets and cinematography basically do the same thing. They transform something dead into something alive, and herein lies all their magic.
Hence your praise of puppets?
Exactly. As an author, von Böhn is rather terrible. I did not want to praise him. I praised the puppet. Because if we understand and feel its magic, it reminds us of cinematography as a minor technology and more generally of a different form of technology, a second technology, as I called it. But that's a different story.
Thank you, and see you around in the cinema.